بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا رب العالمين All praise is due to Allah and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase our knowledge and benefit us with the knowledge we have acquired. Ameen. Brothers and sisters in Islam, let us first have the proper intention in our hearts to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In our lesson, we'll continue talking about the obligatory knowledge. And we'll talk about chapter of purification. The scholars of Islam would mention this chapter before the chapter of prayer, because prayer is in need of purification. Without proper purification, one's prayer is invalid. For that reason, the scholars would mention this chapter about purification before the chapter about prayer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentioned in the Quran the following ayah: إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ التَّوَّابِينَ وَيُحِبُّ الْمُتَطَهِّرِينَ, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commends those who repent. So if they commit a sin, they rush to repentance. And those who give a great attention to the matters of purification. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith narrated by Imam Muslim, الطهور شطر الإيمان. الطهور شطر الإيمان. Literally it means purification is half of faith. But the meaning of this hadith is purification is a very important part of our religion. In Hajj, when performing Hajj, especially when we talk about tawaf, tawaf is in need of purification. Prayer is in need of purification. There are many matters in our religion that rely on purification. So if one's purification is not valid, then one's prayer is not valid as a consequence for performing invalid purification. One should not be shy when learning about purification, because he is in need of such a knowledge, especially when one is asking about matters that are deep. He might go to a knowledgeable person and ask him about these matters to be able to know how his act of worship would be valid. The ladies at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would come to the Prophet and ask him about matters of purification, the purificatory bath, about menses, about all these matters relating to women they would come to the Prophet and ask him about them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would explain to them. And as mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari, that once a lady approached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him about what to do after her menses terminate. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained to her. Then she asked for more details. He tried to explain to her. She asked for more details. Then Aisha, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, took her aside and explained to her in detail. This is one of the reasons, if someone were to ask you, why would the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam marry more than once? That was one of the main reasons. So religion can spread faster through women. Because many ladies feel shy to ask a male about these matters, so they would prefer to go to a female who is knowledgeable and ask her about these matters. They need to learn. Otherwise, as you can see, many women these days are unaware of these matters. They don't know when to start praying. They don't know when to stop praying. They don't know when they have to do the purificatory bath. They don't know all these matters. And they don't learn, as they say, they feel shy. But you find them in other matters, if they were to go into a business and other matters, they would go and ask many people about these matters. But when it comes to matters pertaining to their religion, because they pertain to the matters of purification, they say they feel shy to ask about these matters. Aisha radiallahu anha said, نِعْمَ النِّسَاءُ نِسَاءُ الْأَنصَارِ لَمْ يَمْنَعْهُنَّ الْحَيَاءُ أَن يَتَفَقَّهْنَ فِي الدِّينِ. Meaning the best women are the women of Al-Ansar. Who are the Ansar? Al-Ansar are the supporters of the Prophet in Medina. Aisha radiallahu anha is saying the best women are the women of Al-Ansar. Shyness did not stop them from acquiring the knowledge of the religion. So when one is in need, he would go to a sheikh, to a knowledgeable person, to ask about these matters. He shouldn't feel shy, whether a man or a woman. They should ask about these matters. It's like when you get sick, for instance, even if you have a problem in your private part, you would go to a doctor and you might show your prohibited nakedness to the doctor because you are suffering from this matter. You want to be cured. So here you don't feel shy, you go to the doctor to give you medication and maybe to, for instance, do an operation for you. In your religion, if you need to know about something, even if it pertains to these matters, you need to learn about these matters. Otherwise, you would perform an invalid act of worship. Invalid act of worship. I've heard about some woman who used to think that if she has intercourse with her husband, then she needs to wash only the bottom part of the body. She doesn't have to have a full purificatory bath. She used to think that after having sexual intercourse, all what she needs to do is wash the bottom part of the body. This is not true. She has to do a full purificatory bath. And she used to think that only when menses terminate, that one she needs to have a full purificatory bath. This is from ignorance. It was mentioned that a person was in a place where he had no water and he was in a state of major ritual impurity. So he needed to have the purificatory bath. But since he didn't have water, he had only the soil. You know how tayammum is performed? So whether for wudu, instead of wudu or instead of the purificatory bath, it's very simple. As Allah mentioned in the Quran, فَامْسَحُوا بِوُجُوهِكُمْ وَأَيْدِيكُمْ مِنْهِ All what you need to do, strike it twice, wipe your face and wipe your hands up to and including the elbows. This is tayammum with a specific intention. It's very simple. Now that person, because he did not acquire the knowledge about religion pertaining to these matters, and he was in such a place where there was no water, he started having like a full bath with soil, putting the sand on his body, as if he's having shower with sand. That is due to what? Due to ignorance. So one needs to learn in order to be sure that he is performing the acts of worship in the way that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained them to the nation. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said once, pray as you saw me praying, not pray as you think it's valid to pray. No, he said, pray as you saw me praying. In another hadith he said, whoever performs wudu as I do, as he's ordered, and performs prayer as ordered, meaning as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam performs it, then his sins will come out of his body, and that is in reference to the minor sins, to the extent that they will come out of his body from underneath his fingernails, meaning he will be washed from the minor sins if he performs a valid wudu. So when one performs wudu in the right way and performs prayer in the right way, his minor sins will be washed away. In order to get all these merits, you need to make sure that you are performing these matters in the right way. And we'll start with the book of purification and prayers. When we say purification, we refer to performing what makes it permissible for one to pray, such as wudu or purificatory bath, or what is similar in judgment, like making tayammum. Dry purification is a replacement for what? For wudu, when one doesn't have water, or he cannot use water, that's another reason. Let us say he's burnt, he cannot use water. What does he do in that case? He can perform dry purification, or what is similar to it in physical form, like renewing the wudu. A person might be having wudu, then he prayed Maghrib, let us say, with his wudu, then now it's Isha time. He's still having his wudu, but what is preferred? It is preferred to renew his wudu. Although he has wudu, it is preferred to perform wudu, to pray Isha with a fresh wudu, a new wudu. Because that previous one, he already prayed with the Maghrib prayer. It's not an obligation, it's preferred. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, wudu'un ala wudu, ka'annahu nurun ala nur. Wudu'un ala wudu, performing wudu while one is already on wudu, but just because he prayed with a prayer, now he wants to make another wudu for the following prayer, it's like illumination above illumination. So there is a great merit in doing all these matters. So that's the definition of the purification. When we refer to the prayer is a set of specific sayings and actions, physical actions. It is initiated by saying Allahu Akbar, that's how we start the prayer, concluded by saying Assalamu Alaikum. This is the definition of the prayer. Now we'll start talking about the five obligatory prayers and how each of these prayers, how its time begins, sets in, and how it finishes. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. The prayer was ordained upon the believers to be performed within a designated time. So each prayer has a designated time to be performed in it. Zuhr, prayer, has a beginning and has an end. Asr, prayer, has a beginning and has an end, and so on. So each prayer has a beginning, a setting in time, and an ending time. So one must perform that prayer within that designated time. As the Prophet ﷺ did, when Angel Jibreel ﷺ came to him after the night of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. Because when did the five obligatory prayers being ordained upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his nation? During the night of Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj. During that nighted journey, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took from Al-Masjid Al-Haram in Mecca to Jerusalem, then up to the seven heavens and beyond. Then he came back to Mecca. During that night, it was revealed to the Prophet that it is now an obligation upon him and his nation to pray five obligatory prayers throughout day and night. Five. The following day, Jibreel came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, prayed with the Prophet each prayer at the beginning of its setting in time. The following day he came at a later time and prayed with him, and he said to him, the prayer is between these times, to show the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when to pray each prayer. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, خمس صلوات كتبهن الله على العباد من أتى بهن بتمامهن كان له عند الله عهد أن يدخله الجنة ومن لم يأت بهن فليس له عند الله عهد أن يدخله الجنة إن شاء عذبه وإن شاء أدخله الجنة. In another narration, وَإِنْ شَاءَ غَفَرَ لَهُمْ. This hadith that is narrated by Imam Ahmad, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in it that Allah ordained upon the slaves five obligatory prayers. Whoever performs them properly in the valid way, satisfying their conditions, prerequisites and requisites, avoiding the invalidators, so he's performing these five obligatory prayers in a proper way, he will have a promise from Allah that he will be admitted into paradise. Whoever performs them regularly, inshaAllah ta'ala, it is hoped for him, that will help him stay away from other sins, and it is hoped for this person to be admitted into paradise without prior torture. But whoever does not perform them properly, or he is neglecting some of these obligatory prayers, he's missing out some prayers, as many do unfortunately these days, the Prophet said he won't have that promise from Allah Azza wa Jal. And if he dies in that state, he is under Allah's will, we say. He might be tortured first in hellfire before being admitted into paradise, and he might be forgiven by Allah Azza wa Jal, and he won't be tortured. But we don't know whether this one is going to be pardoned from torture or not. That's why one should be worried about his case in the hereafter if he does not pray the five obligatory prayers regularly, or if he doesn't pray at all. He should be worried, because in such a case one is under a great danger that he will be tortured in the hereafter, a severe punishment in hellfire. One cannot tolerate one dip in hellfire. One cannot tolerate one dip in hellfire. So it's not an easy matter for one to be tortured in hellfire, even if it were to be for a short period of time. Even if it were to be for a short period of time. It's not worth it that you neglect a prayer, You miss out a prayer because you're watching a game, or you're doing such and such, or you are in the marketplace, whatever. You miss out one prayer without an Islamic excuse, and you subject yourself to a severe torture in the hereafter. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. One prayer would not take 5 minutes from you. So do not neglect these prayers. Perform them regularly, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, in a valid way, and you'll have that promise from Allah to be admitted into paradise. Otherwise, the one who does not pray is of two kinds. He's either doesn't pray because he does not consider prayer as an obligation, he does not give any regard to the prayer, and he will be classified a non-believer in that case. The one who negates its obligation, or the one who disregards the prayer, meaning degrades the prayer, is a non-believer. But the one who does not pray, and that's the other type, and you find many of them, they do not pray not because they do not deem the prayer as an obligation. They know it is an obligation, but they do not pray out of laziness. They're lazy to get up, make wudu, and pray. They are lazy. So what's their judgment? They commit a major sin. Those ones are classified Islamically as great sinners. They are damned by Allah Azza wa Jal. Damned, cursed by Allah Azza wa Jal. And there is a great danger that this could lead them to dying in the state of blasphemy, wal-iyazu billah. So it's a major sin. One would be classified as a wicked person. That's the one who doesn't pray. And which type? I'm talking about the second type. The one who knows it is an obligation, but out of laziness he doesn't pray. This could lead him eventually to committing blasphemy, wal-iyazu billahi ta'ala. Because once one stops praying, he has opened all the gates of evil for himself. All the gates of evil has been opened for such a person. But when you pray properly, while satisfying the conditions, requisites and prerequisites, so in a proper way, this inshallah will help you stay away from other sins. It was narrated in the hadith that a person came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said to the Prophet alayhi salat wasalam, "O Messenger of Allah, so and so," he mentioned a person, "he prays, but he steals." He's known that he used to steal, but he used to pray. Now some ignorant people these days, if they know of a person who prays but he commits another sin, they say to him, "Don't pray." Walayyazu billah. If they see a lady that prays but she doesn't wear the scarf, they say to her, "Don't pray if you do not wear the scarf." Ignorance. Ignorance. This person asked the Prophet about a Muslim who used to pray but he used to steal as well. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "His prayer will stop him one day from stealing." He said, "But he prays and he steals." The Prophet said, "His prayer will stop him one day from stealing." And this is what happened. After a while, he stopped stealing. He became a good Muslim. Performing the prayers regularly is an enlightenment. Is an enlightenment for your life. Even when your heart, you know how every day, you need to look after yourself. See how you groom yourself on a daily basis. See when you have shower so you don't stink. You do all these things regularly. What does wudu and prayer do for you? When you perform wudu, that will help you. That will help you against the devil. That's why when one gets angry, you know, and anger is from the devil. When one gets angry, What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam recommend for one who gets angry to calm himself down? To do what? To perform wudu. Wudu will help him calm down. Wudu will help him calm down when he is in a state of anger. And the one who doesn't pray, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, and here we're referring to the one who doesn't pray out of what? Out of laziness. So he's not a non-believer. He is a believer. However, he does not pray. But he is a believer. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that such a person will find no light of guidance on the day for judgment. No proof to defend himself with, and no safety on the day for judgment. On top of that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that he will be assembled with Fir'aun. You know who is Fir'aun? The Pharaoh of Egypt, the tyrant Pharaoh mentioned in the Quran, who said to people, "I am your Lord." Who said to people, "I haven't known a God for you other than myself." That's the Pharaoh. Such a person, the one who does not pray, will be assembled with Pharaoh of Egypt, Haman, his advisor, Qarun, an unbeliever at the time of Prophet Musa alayhi salam, and Ubay ibn Khalaf, one of the leaders of the non-believers at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So when the Prophet is mentioning that the one who does not pray will be assembled with these non-believers, heads of blasphemy, if you can say that, this is to show how extreme, how severe his sin is. So do not ever neglect the five obligatory prayers, no matter what. Make time for these prayers. And remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordained upon you these five obligatory prayers, and they won't take half an hour from you. Half an hour from you. It was mentioned that Abu Darda, one of the great companions, radiallahu anhu, said, "Pray two rak'ahs in the darkness of the night for the darkness of the grave." Pray two rak'ahs in the darkness of the night for what? For the darkness of the grave. You know how many who have passed away already and got buried in their graves now, they would wish if they would have a chance to come back to this world and pray. Even two rak'ahs, even to perform one sujood for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just one sujood for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why you need to give these five obligatory prayers a great attention. Make sure you perform wudu properly. Don't be in rush, as some people may do. Just they are in rush, so they don't perform prayers properly. Once at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a trouble, and some of the companions were late, so they rushed to make wudu to catch up with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to pray in congregation. But as they were in rush, they were performing wudu quickly, hastily. But the Prophet realized that some of them were about to miss out washing the heels, and the heel is part of the foot. It must be washed in wudu. So he realized that they were about to miss out washing this part, the heel. So the Prophet said loudly, in a loud voice, warning them. He said, "Waylun lil-a'qabi minan-nar," meaning those who do not wash this part, the heel of their foot in wudu, deserve that these heels to be burnt in hellfire on the day of judgment. So he was warning them about these matters. That's why, remember, take your time, perform wudu properly, perform the prayer properly, it wouldn't take 5 minutes from you. And look, compare the amount of time you spend on your phone or watching YouTube or Facebook or the like, and the amount that is required of you to perform the 5 obligatory prayers. Trust me, if you were to have the statistics for your daily use of your phone, I'm sure you will see that you are spending hours on your phone. Hours. Am I right? Minimum hours these days, unfortunately. Now kids are spending hours now, little kids. But the 5 obligatory prayers, to pray them properly, it won't take half an hour from you. With khushu'ah, submission to Allah Azza wa Jal. If at the beginning you don't find yourself having this submission when you pray, the feeling of veneration to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the fear of Allah, you don't have it in your heart, you don't see yourself having that fear of Allah in your heart, this is because your heart had what? Rusted. So don't worry, it needs a time to cleanse your heart from this rust. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the hearts would get rusted. And the way to remove the rust from the hearts is by making istighfar. Say, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. That will help you. Because if your heart is rusted, your heart is sick, unhealthy, your whole body will be unhealthy. If your heart is healthy, then your whole body will be healthy, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. So it is obligatory to perform 5 obligatory prayers throughout day and night. Only 5. Subh prayer, that's the dawn prayer. Zuhr prayer, the noon prayer. Asr prayer, mid-afternoon prayer. Maghrib prayer, sunset prayer. And Isha prayer, nightfall prayer. 5 prayers. Only these prayers are obligatory upon every accountable Muslim. Only these 5 obligatory prayers. We know from this that witr, you know, witr that you pray after Isha, is not an obligation, but it is highly recommended to perform witr every night after Isha. When you pray Isha and you pray Sunnah after that, pray witr before you go to sleep. That's highly recommended. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has increased you on top of the prayers that you pray, the 5 obligatory prayers, a prayer which is al-witr. So make sure you perform al-witr regularly. It's highly recommended. In the school of Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, not praying al-witr for no Islamic excuse is sinful. He didn't say al-witr is an obligation. He says it's wajib. According to Imam Abu Hanifa, wajib is under fard, under obligation. They call it wajib, it's under fard. According to him, if you don't pray, you are sinful, if you don't have an Islamic excuse. Now the proof about the obligation of only these 5 prayers is known from the hadith narrated by Al-Bukhari. Narrated by Al-Bukhari, in which a person came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him, O Messenger of Allah, tell me about the obligatory prayers that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained upon me. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, these 5 obligatory prayers. Then he said, tell me about the obligatory fasting that Allah ordained upon me. The Prophet said, the month of Ramadan. He kept on asking about the obligations only. And the Prophet answered him. After he finished, the person went away. As he was walking away, he looked at the Messenger of Allah and said, I swear by Allah who sent you truly to us, I will not add anything to these obligations, and I will not miss out any of them. So basically, he wants to perform only the obligations. He doesn't want to perform any optional deed, any optional prayer. He wants to stick to these obligations, the five obligatory prayers, and fasting the month of Ramadan. He doesn't want to perform more recommended matters, but at the same time, he doesn't want to miss out any of the obligations. He said, I swear by Allah who sent you truly to us, that I will not add to these obligations, and I will not miss out any of them. What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أفلح الرجل إن صدق. In another narration, دخل الجنة إن صدق, meaning he will succeed if he acts upon what he mentioned. In another narration, if he acts upon what he mentioned, he will be admitted into paradise. So make sure first that you perform the obligations. Even if you don't perform the optional, rewardable deeds, but the minimum is to perform the obligations. Because you won't be held accountable on the day of judgment for not performing the recommended matters, as the Prophet mentioned here in this hadith narrated by Bukhari. But do not miss out any of the obligations. After you see yourself steadfast on performing the obligations, add to them from the optional deeds, whether optional prayers, optional fasting, that will raise your rank on the day of judgment. You will elevate on the day of judgment. That will help you. You know, one of the scholars in the past from the Salaf, the predecessors, called Thabit al-Bunani, was a righteous Muslim. He said, I struggled with myself for 20 years to perform the prayers, meaning optional prayers. He was referring to optional prayers. He used to perform the obligatory prayers, and he wanted to get used to praying the optional prayers. So he was struggling with himself for the first 20 years. It's not easy. The devil wouldn't like it. Yourself wouldn't like it. Yourself would tend to what? Having a rest. Would tend to being comfortable in this life. This is what yourself tends to in this life. Have a rest now. Watch TV, do such and such, wasting time. But to get up and pray, it's hard on the self. So he said, I struggled with myself for 20 years. Then I started enjoying praying the optional prayers. Started feeling that special taste for the following 20 years. To an extent that it was mentioned that for 40 years, not 4 days, he would stay all night praying. All night. Praying until dawn. All night. And it was mentioned that just before dawn, and this time, the hour before dawn, the time before dawn, the supplication is more likely to be fulfilled. So just before dawn, he would supplicate Allah. He would say, oh Allah, if you were ever to grant a person the virtue of praying in his grave, I ask you to grant me this merit, to pray in his grave. To that extent, so in this life he used to spend his time at night praying, and he's looking for this virtue as well, for this merit, to be able to pray in the grave. So when he died, they buried him. And as Al-Hafiz Abu Nu'aym Al-Asbahani mentioned in his book Hilyat Al-Awliya, he had a book called Hilyat Al-Awliya. He mentioned in this book that this righteous Muslim, Thabit Al-Bunani, when he died, the two who buried him in his grave and placed him in his lahad. The lahad is the cavity in the direction of Qibla. If the soil is solid, then they dig like an L shape. So, and they place the deceased in that cavity in the direction of the Qibla, then they put like bricks to cover it, then they put the soil on this side. This is called lahad, that cavity in the grave in the direction of the Qibla. So the one who placed him in the grave, he said, I swear by Allah, I was the one who placed Thabit in his grave, in his lahad, that cavity. And as I was putting the bricks to cover it, one brick fell inside towards his body. So in order to get it, he put his head inside and he was surprised to see Thabit al-Bunani standing in his grave praying. He was surprised, shocked. Then he called his friend, he said, come and see, come and see. He said, what? He said, look, he's praying in the grave. He said, don't talk about it. Let us finish burying him first. So they buried him. They went back to his daughter. They said to her, tell me what your father used to do in this life. What did he used to do in this life? She said, and what did you see? She knew. They told her the story. She said, my father used to pray all night for 40 years. 40 years, all night. And just before dawn, he would raise his hands and make supplication to Allah Azza wa Jal, saying, O Allah, if you were ever to grant a person the virtue of praying in his grave, grant me this virtue. And Allah wouldn't reject him after praying that long period of time at night, 40 years, praying and making a supplication at the end of the night. So Allah granted him that virtue. This is mentioned in the book Hilyat al-Awliya. So what do we learn from this? Is once you start feeling that taste of enjoyment when praying, it won't become hard on yourself to get up and pray. Rather, you'll be waiting. It's like you're missing something. Not waiting for a fight to take place on TV, and you send messages about this fight, about this game, whatever, watch tonight, and they put a countdown for the fight to start, whatever, subhanAllah. That will not benefit you in anything. You should be waiting for the next prayer. You should be waiting for the next prayer. Longing for the next prayer. When it's going to start, I want to pray. I want to have more khushu' inshaAllah Azza wa Jal. I'm trying to pray this prayer better than the prayer that I prayed before. This is what you do. Not to think about all these worldly matters that won't help you in, not even in worldly matters. They make you pay money. They pay money to watch them sometimes. So you're losing in worldly matters and in religious matters. What do you get from that? Wasting your time, wasting your money, whatever, whatever. That's why plan your life around the prayer. Don't ever think about missing out one obligatory prayer. Bukhari narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in the hadith that if one misses out performing the Asr prayer, as an example, but this applies to all the prayers. If one misses out the Asr prayer without an excuse, it's worse for him than losing all his family members and all his wealth all at once. How hard would it be for one? Just imagine you're sitting down and they tell you, all your family members are dead now. You lost everything, all your money. It's a harsh impact on him. The Prophet is saying that if you miss out performing the Asr prayer without an excuse, it's like you have lost all your money, all your wealth, and all your family members all at once. See how important the prayer is? I'm telling you this just to think about how important is it for one to be regular and performing these prayers. Once you keep in your heart the importance of these obligatory prayers, you know the importance of learning about purification, requisites, prerequisites, invalidators of the prayer, and so on, to make sure that you are praying in the right way. Otherwise, performing what seems to be a prayer, meaning outwardly, is not enough. It's not enough. How many ladies would not put the scarf properly and they show their neck here and then they go and they pray, they say. It's invalid. Or they might wear a see-through scarf that it shows the color of the skin from underneath her and they pray. The prayer is invalid. So even if you perform what seems to be for rak'ahs and so on, your prayer is invalid. How many ladies, they put nail polish, and some of them they put that clear one. It doesn't make any difference. Clear or with color, it's a layer. It prevents water from reaching the part that must be washed in the prayer. And then they go and pray. And some of them, they come up with an innovation of misguidance. And they're trying to spread this around. What do? They make wudu, they say. Then they put nail polish. Then in the following prayer, they say they wash on top of it. What is this? Is that a foot ghee? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned about the foot ghee. If one performs wudu, then he wears a foot ghee. If the following prayer, its time sets in and he doesn't have wudu, he can perform wudu. Instead of washing his feet, he can do a wet wipe on it. That's called al-khuf, the foot ghee. The nail polish is not a foot ghee. They come up with strange things out of laziness because they don't give that regard to the matters of the religion. And the Prophet said, remember this, the one who performs these five obligatory prayers, giving them the regard needed and the attention needed while performing the requisites and prerequisites and avoiding the invalidators, what kind of reward he would get? He will have that promise of Allah to be admitted into paradise. What a great promise from Allah Azza wa Jal. But if you don't perform these five obligatory prayers out of laziness, you are a major sinner, but not a non-believer. Not a non-believer. From the hadith that I mentioned earlier, when the Prophet mentioned that the one who performs them properly will have that promise from Allah to be admitted into paradise. But the one who does not perform them, what happens? The Prophet didn't say he is kafir. The Prophet didn't say he is a non-believer, will be in hellfire forever. The Prophet, he said he is under the will of Allah. He might be forgiven by Allah and be admitted into paradise without prior torture. And he might be tortured first, then be admitted into paradise afterwards. So he is under the will of Allah. That means he's not a non-believer. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from falling into blasphemy and major sins and to make our end in this life as righteous Muslims. Ameen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. We say la ilaha illallah and we make salah on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.